I'm going to show you everything about Kiro AI, the new agentic IDE from Amazon, as fast as possible. By the end of this video, you will know that how do we build this entire Flappy Birds game using just one or two sentences as prompts, and every planning, specification, and implementation was actually done by Kiro AI. Kiro AI's agent plan everything from the start, the architecture, the plan of creating the actual app, and then implementing it. In this video, I'm going to show you how that works. If you are watching this, follow along for the entire video. This would take around 15 to 20 minutes. Try to follow every step on yourself. It's in waitlist right now because a lot of people signed up on the product. So you cannot download it from the official website. But you can go on this other website, kiro.help/download. From here, you can download for Mac, Windows, and Linux. It's available for all three here. Talk about pricing. Kiro has a very generous free tier. You get 50 requests for free. And even beyond that, there is a $19 plan, which gives you 1,000 requests every month, which is actually twice or thrice if you compare it with Cursor or Windsurf. So it's actually a pretty good deal even after their free preview. Once you download it, then you have to install it on your system and you have to log in using either GitHub or your Amazon account. Don't try it with Google because a lot of people are not able to use it through Google in this waitlist period. Once you download Kiro, it would look very familiar because it's built on the same foundation as Vim. We even offer you to import your settings from other tools like Cursor or VS Code or Vim. Now, here's the first thing that you need to understand about Kiro. If I open up a project over here, you will see that on the right, there are two modes. One is Vibe, which is very similar to any other AI code editor, but another is spec-driven development. This is the secret sauce. Over here, whenever you give out a feature request, it will first do the entire planning. Then it will write specifications based on how your app is already built out. And then it will make a step-by-step plan on how to execute it, because LLMs only work well when they have a clear plan and every step is bite-sized. It's like having a developer who understands what it's doing. It even writes test cases, which is actually a very integral part of traditional software development, but almost no vibe coding tool do it automatically. So let's come on the screen and I will click on open a project. In this you can select any root directory. Root directory is basically any folder on your computer. I have created a new folder here called testing grok. Within this I will create a new subfolder. I will call this Flappy Birds and I will create this here. I will click on open and then I will have access to the entire interface. Let's look at the UI. On the left, you will see Kiro settings. And if you click on this top icon here, you will be redirected to File Explorer. Right now, there are no files, so we don't see anything over here. But let's go back on Kiro settings. Now, within Kiro settings, there are four major things. First is specifications. This would be created based on whatever feature or app we want to create. This would be created automatically. Second is agent hooks. This is a way of automating repetitive tasks. For example, you can set up automated triggers before every time you push code or make any changes, this should push it online. Third is agent steering. This is used for defining custom rules for your AI. We won't be using agent hooks or agent steering today. And the last one over here are MCP servers. You would have heard of MCP servers. They are basically a way of communicating with different apps. So I have Superbase's MCP over here. I won't be covering it in this video, but we would be covering all of this in subsequent videos in this series. In this video, I would be taking you all the initial steps that you need to take while setting up Kiro and start using it. Now in the middle, you will see the interface through which we would be interacting the most. This would be used for creating all the feature requests. Vibe mode helps when you want to make changes to a specific file, while specs really help when you want to create a detailed feature request or when you're trying to start a new project. So in this case, we want to create a Flappy Birds game. So let me just add a very basic prompt here. First, I will define that I want to create a Next.js project. Next.js is basically a framework for creating apps. You can use other frameworks as well, but Next.js is something that most coding models are really good at. Then I will mention what we want to build.
we want to build out the Flappy Birds game. The game needs to have a bird. Also in Flappy Birds, the bird keeps on moving in forward direction and it is also affected by gravity. There would be obstacles in between and all of them needs to be of variable height. And on this, we would also want to show the score of the user on top right, and the game ends every time the bird hits an obstacle. Then show the user their score and give the option to restart. So this is the entire app we build out, and this is actually the only context that we are gonna give it to it. I will just mention this prompt here, and after pressing enter, I will let it think and create requirements. You will see that it is creating a doc called requirements. When I click on it, I am redirected to this interface. Over here, there are three tabs, requirements, design, and task list. These are the three steps in which it explains and give its reasoning on what it's trying to build. So let's just go through the requirements document to see that if everything that it has understood from our prompt is correct. First thing is the feature involves creating a Flappy Bird game using Next.js. The game will feature a bird that automatically moves forward with gravity physics, obstacles of variable heights, and a live scoring system, and the game over functionality with restarts capability. The game should provide an engaging browser-based game experience with smooth animations and responsive controls. Let's go through requirement one. As a player, I want to control the bird that automatically moves forward so that I can focus on navigating through obstacles. And there are also multiple acceptance criteria over here. This is actually pretty cool. This is thinking from a perspective of a player. Then as a player, I want the bird to be affected by gravity so that games feels realistic and challenging. And this is also considered the case when the bird reaches the bottom of the screen, in which case the game ends. So this is actually pretty interesting. We did not even mention it, but this is actually how the game works. Just like this, it has came up with 7 requirements. At this stage, you can either make changes to it, but this looks good to me. So I will just click on move to design phase. Let's go ahead. So this is the second tab over here. And now it has generated the entire design. Over here, I see that there are a lot of different components. It has also mentioned that which technology stack it will use, you know, which hooks it would be using, which is the API it would be using. So far, I did not even mention that what I wanted, and it has already figured out that what are the data models, what are all the edge cases, how it will manage all of this. It has also came up with a testing strategy. This is something that was insanely cool to me when I tried it for the first time, because even most of the developers don't write their tests themselves. So this AI actually also write tests for you, so that when you are making changes to any element in the future, it would make sure that its core functionality does not get disturbed. I will now click on move to implementation phase. When I click on this, then it will start creating this tasks.md file. And when I go within this file, there would be all the sub-steps that needs to be completed for creating this entire app. So overall, it has came up with 17 steps that it would have to do to build out this entire app. I can also go through each step and I can tell it to break down any of these steps into multiple parts or anything like that. I won't be doing it since our objective is to see that what is the easiest way of using this, and even then, does it create something that is actually good. I will click on the first one here. I will just click on start task, and that will automatically send the details of the first task in this queue here. So when I send this, I see this message execution queued because there is an open list of tasks. Right now it works on one task. So over here, I have to give my input to finalize this. I'll just click on looks good to me. And once I click this, then this task would be finished. Now, if I go back to this task one window, I will see that it has started executing it. So it tells me that right now the model that I'm selecting has a lot of traffic, but let's stick with Claude Sonnet 4 since it's the latest model and it has been working really well for me. It's a major upgrade from 3.7. One thing over here is every time it runs a command, it will give you an option to run this, reject this, or trust this. When you click on trust, Then it will ask you to select if you want to trust the full command or the partial command or the base command. What this means is that if I click on trusting any command, then it saves it in the list of all the commands that are in the allow list, which means that next time when this command comes up in the process, it will automatically execute that. So it could become even more automated down the line, which is actually pretty cool. And you can select which command do you want it to execute automatically and which one you don't want to. So commands like deleting a file is something that you don't want to allow it to run itself, but something like creating a new file is fine because you can always undo that. Now when it ran the command, then we have to mention some of the things in the terminal here. Terminal is a way for us to just communicate with the computer. So to proceed, press Y. I will just click on Y. Then it will start creating all the files. I see that the directory Flappy Bird contains some files that could conflict. It says the reason why this did not work out is because we already have a .kiro file. So now it's manually creating all the files and doing that, which is also fine by me. Let me create all of these. The best benefit of using this is that it also creates its own test cases so that it can just test what's working, what's not, and make changes to it. So let's wait while it executes the entire task, and we can just go through this entire process, executing step 2, step 3, and all of that. Great, it's done executing all the subtasks within step 1. Now it wants to run a command. I will just click on run here because I don't want it to run this command on itself every time. So it started running this program on my local system. Let's just click on the link over here. This link is where this would be running on the local system. If I click on this, it should show me a blank project right now. But if it opens up, then I would know that it has set up the base repository or the project correctly. So I see Flappy Bird game will be implemented here. So this is perfectly what we wanted. So let's just go back here. And next it wants to run sleep3 command. I will let it run this. The first step is done. Similarly, we will start with the second step. I will just click on start tasks and it will start executing all of this. You can actually do anything else with it. I was just shitposting on Twitter while this was actually completing the entire task. I will check this in between, seeing that if it needs my interference anywhere before it runs any specific command. And yeah, apart from that, I will just let it run everything itself. What you can also do is you can also queue all these tasks. So if the third task is running and if I click on start task on the fourth task, it will add it to its queue. And once the third task is done, then it will start executing the fourth task itself. But I've seen that it sometimes fail when you add more than two or three tasks. So it might be a bug that they're working on. But down the line, when this is completely fixed, you can just automate this entire thing where you just click on, start task, or maybe they might add a start all task button and it will execute everything end to end on itself. And we are done running the final task. Now let's try running this app. And for running this, we would be using this command called npm run dev. Let me press enter. And this would give us a link. This is the local link of the app, which means that only we can open this on our system. No one else can view it yet. So I will copy this link and I will go on my browser and I will paste this. Also note one thing, I did not made any changes to any of these tasks here. Now let's look at the game. Overall, I really like the color choices here. This looks really vibrant, something that I would expect in a game. Then if I look at how to play, I can either tap or I can press the space bar to make the bird jump. Also, one little detail is that the bird also has a small eye, which is actually very cute. And it also has a beak. I really like the details on this. Let's start pressing space. And if you look closely, you will also see that the bird is sweating on every jump, which is actually pretty amazing. And then there is also gradient on all of these obstacles. And I'm actually pretty bad at this game, but if you look closely, you will also notice that all these obstacles are of variable heights and the distance between them is actually also variable. sometimes it's larger and sometimes it's smaller. I'm actually pretty amazed considering that we only gave it like a 3 lines long prompt at the start, and then it created requirements based on that. Then it also created a design document, which basically creates the entire architecture on how we would be building this. And then it created every task, it ran all of these itself. So that's Kiro. And what makes it so much powerful is the entire planning layer that they have added on top of it. Is this good enough to replace senior developers right now? I don't think so. But is it better than any other AI app builder out there right now? Yes, definitely. This is way better than Cursor or Windsurf. And this is absolutely the best tool if you're trying to create something yourself and you don't have technical skills. And in this video, we haven't touched the advanced features like agent hooks, which helps in automating repetitive tasks, or agent steering, which is like a custom prompt for the agent, or even MCPs, which helps you build out multiple integrations with things like Supabase or any external app. In the coming days, I would be creating videos on all of these topics and showing you exact workflow that I am using with Kiro. So make sure that you subscribe to the channel and you turn on the bell notification so that you get to know when I release a video. Or if you are watching this video after a while, then there would mostly be a playlist around Kiro AI on my channel already. If you like this video, then make sure that you drop a like and you comment what you would want me to build next with Kiro AI. And that's all for this video. I will see you in the next one. Thanks for sticking till the end. Bye bye.